È un piacere continuare questa plenaria del Biwisa invitando a salire sul palco una persona che lavora nel digitale dal 1992 e che studia l'impatto delle trasformazioni digitali sulla società. È una persona che riesce a farci vedere e toccare con mano i cambiamenti in corso e soprattutto le conseguenze a livello comportamentale sulle persone. È un piacere invitare qui sul palco, direttamente dall'Olanda, Jan William Alphenaar. Thank you, Jan. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Thank you.
Here is your audience. E io vi prego di fare un applauso a Jan, ma soprattutto alle sue scarpe. Ok, lascio a te il pubblico. Un altro applauso a Jan, grazie.
Talking about human experience, this is one of the best experiences you can have, really. Standing over here, and I'm trying to digitize that experience using my VR camera, but I just lost my battery, so I have to be here to experience it. This is me. I'm here as a trend watcher, and I'm fascinated by all technology and digital developments and how it affects society and businesses. I also wrote 7 books, 5 about LinkedIn. I do a lot with LinkedIn, but today I'm mainly to talk to you about digitization and should it replace the human experience. And one of the things that fascinates me most about technology, which I started using when I was 11 years old in 1981, I had a first computer. In 1992, I was for my first time online. And still I'm fascinated about the speed of how fast things are going. When you look at radio, it took them 38 years to get 50 million users. It's quite a long time, you cannot imagine that anymore. When you look at television, it only took 13 years, but they could advertise on the radio, so maybe that's why it was quicker. Then we had the internet, it only took 4 years to get 50 million users. Then came, of course, the Facebook, 3.5 years, and a stupid game like Angry Birds only took 35 days. And that's how fast things are going. That's how fast we adapt technology and changes in technology. Or this one. You know what's going on over here? Anyone? Any idea what people are playing over here? Right, Pokemon Go. Oh. How fast did that one go? Nobody could have imagined that it would be such a success. And now nobody plays it anymore, I think. But when you look at 1957, it took 14 people to move in one computer. And today, when you look at the streets are blocked by people using computers. So we are all used to this, and we're all using our screens all of the time. The Germans, during World War I, 1970, they came up with an idea to put cameras on pigeons. They flew over the enemy lines to see where the enemies were, but it took them 3 days to develop the pictures, if the pigeons came back, and then, well, information was already lost. And now for only $1,500, we can all buy a DJI, a drone that can fly for over 7 kilometers and send us real-time 4K digital image. It's amazing. This is what amazes me the most. Did any one of you ever see one of these machines?
No.
No? Maybe you recognize this one? Yeah. The Viewmaster? You still have one?
Yeah.
You put it on and it was almost like a virtual world. And now we just put on our VR glasses and we can see almost everything. And I like this. Have you seen this? I received this one yesterday. It's what happens in 60 seconds on the internet at this time.
So you can do the math. While I'm speaking here, how many tweets are sent or how many snaps are created. It's just an amazing speed on how many digital garbage we put online. It's too much data, but Lisa will use the data for her benefit, so it's great for you, Lisa. It was asked before by Lisa, how many people know Star Trek in the audience? Who have never heard of Star Trek before? Okay, great, I love it. When you look at the old Star Trek series, you will see that they have some interesting ideas and concepts that are implemented today. When I look at one of the first episodes, well, it was late 60s, Captain Kirk, the one on the right, is using a computer. But it's not a computer like we were used in that time. It's a portable computer. What does it look like? Yeah, it is an iPad. This man, Captain Spock, you all know the ears. He uses a small device to copy data from one computer to another computer. Like we did with my presentation. It's called a USB stick. They didn't use any cloud solutions at that time. This one, I think only Lisa knows what it is. I hope. A tricorder, anyone ever heard about it? Tricorder, yeah. It's a device where you can measure almost anything. Environmental details like temperature, moist, but also physical, how do you call it? Physical state of a person. If any organs are wrong, or how the blood pressure is, and temperature. And nowadays, when you use the right tools and connect the right sensors, you can use your iPhone to do the same. Or just buy the Xenadu. This one measures 7 vital life signs just by putting it on the front of your head. It's no longer science fiction, it's here. Or this one, the big screens. They use those screens to communicate with other spaceships or with other planets. And nowadays we all have them in our homes and we can watch the rover driving on Mars from our own living room. We can use Skype to call with everybody in the world as long as the time is the same. Because when you call someone in Australia at this time, I don't think they like it. And this astronaut, that's a Dutch guy, André Kuipers, when he was flying in the ISS around the world, he was tweeting pictures of the planet. So while he was in space, we could see what was happening on Earth from his point of view. And we even had a chat with him using Google Hangouts while he was in space. So the communication in space is already there. And do you remember this hero?
Yeah.
Felix Baumgartner. One crazy guy that jumped from 30 kilometers down to Earth. And we could watch it online, YouTube live, with 6 different cameras. How amazing is that? When he jumped, that's already 5 years ago. And we could live see what he was doing, hoping that he would make it, of course. In the future, and I think it will be the near future, it will be possible for us to travel to space. When you look at Richard Branson with his Virgin Atlantic, Elon Musk of the Tesla with his SpaceX, the guy Benson from Amazon is working on space traveling. They're all working on space traveling. It's no longer a country thing, it's a company thing. And I think commercial space flights, I think we will all live to see that. And I think that will be quite interesting. This one is the most famous thing from Star Trek. What do people say about Star Trek normally when they see this picture?
Beam me up.
Beam me up.
Scotty.
Scotty, yeah, that's true. This thing was a teleporting machine. So I would stand here and it would dematerialize me and would put me somewhere else. It's not possible yet, not with humans, but it is possible with information. And they did it in the Delft University in Holland. They had some data over here and it disappeared and it appeared somewhere else. Not using Wi-Fi or any cable, it just worked. And when the researchers were interviewed, they asked, how does it work? And they said, well, actually, we don't know, but we do know that it works. So maybe in the future, once they get a grip on that, we will teleport things. So you can be dematerialized, sent over through a fiber cable, and appear next on Mars. I don't know if that's interesting, but it can happen. This is an amazing machine, and I think everybody would love to have it. It's called a replicator. And you say to the machine, okay, I want to have spaghetti bolognese, and poof, there's spaghetti bolognese. That would be nice, right? But today we have 3D printers. And with 3D printing comes a very nice development. And I want to warn you up front. This might be scary for you, I tell the people. So don't tell me on this one, but there is something frightening happening.
This pizza has just been printed.
It's the Americans that are printing a pizza. And I tasted a part of it in Holland during the Dutch Design Week, and it tasted terrible. But I think it's a matter of time before it will taste like a real pizza. So the complete food printing will be a development that, yeah, that can change a lot of industries. But this is not what I think will be the future of food. The future of food is this one. Can you please turn up the volume a little bit? Science fiction. It will be commercially available in 2018. In 1 year, you can buy this robot that will create recipes invented by real chefs. All you need to do is get the right ingredients and download the recipe. And I think this will be amazing. And of course, a lot of chefs will lose their jobs. But one really hard to understand thing is this company, Habits, it's working out in Silicon Valley, and what they do, they give you recipes based on your DNA. So you will get food that suits you. I don't know if it's tasty food, but it might be better for your body. Well, I think if I want to have a pizza, I eat a pizza, whether it's good or not. But they're working on it. This is also one of the 3D printing things. In China, they printed this house in 8 days. It's a complete house. So 3D printing is getting quite big, and they're also using it in the medical industry. People are claiming that they can print a human kidney or any other organ using your own stem cells. So you will have a body-owned organ. And that will be amazing, because we don't need donors anymore in the future. Once one part of your body is broken, it can be replaced by a printed thing. And they're working on the pancreas already. Yeah, the pancreas cancer is what kills Steve Jobs. That will be available, I think, in 6 years. So we will have a new organ. It's much more different than just a pacemaker, but it's some sort of technology. No, this is a real human thing, so your body will accept it. And that might be quite amazing. And one other thing of Star Trek, it's called the holodeck. And this is a really interesting thing, because you enter a room and the whole world becomes a new reality. And it feels like real, and people can learn things about themselves, experience new things. And nowadays, we can experience the things like this. It's what virtual reality can do for us. So, I always use Star Trek to tell people what the future will look like. And not because the creators of Star Trek were that foreseeing. No, it's because all the nerds of today were fans of Star Trek. So if you want to know what will be big in the next 10 years, watch Star Trek of 20 years ago. It will be there. Elon Musk was a Trekkie. Steve Jobs was a Trekkie. They were all inspired by Star Trek. Well, then I come to Steve Jobs. I think this invention, the iPhone, 10 years ago, was one of the most revolutionary inventions of this decennium. Because before that, nobody ever thought that they wanted a phone with internet access. When the first iPhones arrived, it was nice, it was fun to have, but what to do with it? And 10 years later, you can have apps for almost everything. And the app technology is one of the most fascinating things, because when you download a new app, or when you buy a new app, your phone has a new function. It's no longer a phone, it's a chat function. You can use it as a library. Stuff is getting more and more intelligent and controlled by apps. So every device that you buy can change over time as you use it. This is the Google self-driving car, and it was held on by the police. And of course the officer was scared because there was no driving wheel, there was just somebody sitting in the car. And you know why it was held off the road? Because it was driving too slow. The Google car is too safe to work in normal traffic, but they're working on it. So in the future, this will be the thing, the self-driving cars. Well, I like driving, and of course, you're Italian, so you don't want a self-driving Ferrari, right? No, okay, we agree on that. Next of all those smart devices, there's this little thing. That's an Arduino computer, and an Arduino is easy to program, and it only costs $20. So you can buy a complete computer for $20 and use it to program almost everything. Like this. This is Simone Geert. You should check her out on YouTube. She is called the Queen of Shitty Robots. And she creates all kinds of robots to wash her hair, robots to wake her up. It's amazing what she does. And she has no programming experience, but everybody can work with Arduino and create robots. And I'm really fascinated by robots. I was at the Motorcar convention in Germany last year. And well, as you can see, I was posing next to a robot, of course. But the robot in the middle is a new Japanese robot, and they sell it like this is the new nanny. So when you have kids and you want to go away, you just turn on the robot, buy kids, and the robot will take care of your kids. And I think that's really scary. But the Japanese believe it, and they're crazy enough to build it and use it, of course. But not only kids love robots, only also the elderly people. And in Holland, we have a strange culture, and it's hard for you to imagine, but in Holland, when people get older, we put them in a house like they are orphans. It's something that Italian people can never understand, but that's what we do. So we put all the elder people together and have people taking care of them. But now they are using robots to take care of the elderly people.
Mag ik een stuk hebben? Dank u.
Ja.
Omhoog. Midden. Omhoog.
And of course it's easy because they're old and they don't know, they don't realize that it is a robot. But I think this is something we don't want. And I hope you agree on that with me. Yeah. I have to, yeah, one of the topics of my speech should be about customer experience. And my definition of customer experience is about perception. The customer experience is the way that people perceive your business, your products, or the process all around it. And that's something we should always keep on focusing. And since we have computers, since we have internet, we try to digitize our business more and more. And there are several reasons why we do it. I do it myself as well, because I work alone, but I have a big company because everything is automated and using digital tools. And we do that because we want to do some upscaling. Digital tools are easy to use for upscaling your business. We use it to cut down the cost. Of course, I can have a person working for me as a lead generator, but I have a lot of digital tools to do that for me as well. And they work all the time. And it makes things more efficient. And that's all true. And we want to work 24/7, right? You don't want to be awake 24/7, but you want to help and serve your clients and your business all of the time. Well, a good thing about digitization is that it takes out the human errors. And it's quite easy to implement nowadays. You don't need to be a technician to digitize parts of your business. It's cheap, it's easy. And what can be digitized? And a lot of people look at the normal customer journey and try to say, hey, we can digitize this, we can digitize this, we can digitize this. Looking at your own process, not at the process of the customer. I have this slide in it, and it has nothing to do with my presentation. But you can check this website online. It's in England, it's the number one car selling website. It's the most ugly website you will ever see. Everything is moving, but it's successful. This is against all ethics about design, user interface, customer experience, but it works. Remember this website, check it out, be amazed, be scared, and click it away. Remember Napster? Yeah. Napster was amazing. Napster was created by a guy that had problems with copying CDs. He had a music CD and he tried to copy it and all the CDs went broke all of the time, and those discs were quite expensive in those days. So he created some software that could digitize the music and share it with your friends. And it was really underground until the music industry noticed this. And they started suing Napster, and all of a sudden Napster was in the news, all over the news. Conference that Lisa will dream of, And everybody started using Napster because it was in the news. They said, hey, this is nice. I want to use it. It was small, but it became big because of the profits created by the music industry. But now, we don't care about illegal downloading music. We use iTunes, or we just get a subscription on Spotify. So people are willing to pay for services as long as it is convenient. They don't need it for free. They want just the convenience of choosing the songs that they like. And, well, Netflix, it's also big in Italy, right? Of course you can download all series and movies using all kind of websites, but yeah, just paying €9 a month and you get Netflix. So I think that's a funny thing, that as long as we get a lot to choose from, we will use it. Like Alibaba, it's a website that has no warehouses, no sales team actually. All they do is they provide the small factories in China to sell their products using their website. And they're big, they're huge. And it's not even one of the nicest websites. And the TripAdvisor, Paolo showed it already. This is a nice thing that people can share. Oh, there's something happening in the timer over here. 15 minutes, thank you. People use this to give comments on your services. And you don't need to, you don't want to neglect them. But this is, I think, a dishonest model. When I go to a restaurant and I'm rude, of course, the people serving me are also rude to me. They will not give me the best effort. They try to, but it's not easy when you are a bad customer. So when you look at Airbnb, that's much more honest. Did you ever book a room using Airbnb?
Yeah.
The funny thing about Airbnb is that you can rate the room, but the room owner can rate you as a renter as well. So that makes it a much more honest game. And I think that's something that will happen with more things. When I post a bad review on TripAdvisor, please consider that I always post bad things. So it's not really convincing that my review is the best. So I think two-way reviews will be the future. And that's also what's happening in Uber. And Uber is, of course, Paolo used it, including examples this morning. But Uber had the same thing as Napster. It was small, it was underground, although they were trying. But when you look at this picture, it's where Lisa lives. This is the day that the normal cab drivers in London stopped working. They were on strike because of Uber. And when you're in London, you practically need those things. So people came out of the underground and they said, hey, what's going on? Why are you not driving? Yeah, we hate Uber. So everybody's looking, Uber, that's nice. So on the day of the strike of the cab drivers, Uber grew 800% in London. So if you don't want any change, do not protest against it, because it will not work. In old days, when clients had problems, they called you. You had long call centers, people answering the phone, yeah, we understand your problem, we will fix it. But nowadays, they all work with social. Complaining online is a hobby. That's why Twitter is still big, because people use it to complain about almost everything. And it can take a lot of time. So there is a nice tool for that, and that's called the chatbots, where they use automatic responders, and they will try to use some artificial intelligence, but they will have computer programs that will respond to your complaints and your questions. It's pre-programmed, and that's not anything you want to talk to a human. So they're working on how to combine all this technology, specifically the artificial intelligence, to get a more human interaction. And Microsoft had a test with it. Oh, I'll come back to Microsoft in a moment. Does any one of you already have the Amazon Dot or the Google at home? Of course David has. This technology, that's also on your phone, using Siri, can give you answers on questions that you have. And this is coming, well, quite fast, because in England, in America, almost everyone is buying those things. Those machines, in your home, you say, what's the weather outside? And the machine gives you an answer. Or, can you call Lisa for me? And it will call Lisa for you. So that's what's happening now. And Microsoft was trying to do this online. And they did an experiment last year. I don't know if anyone remembers her or the news about Tai. What she did, she started discussing with other people on Twitter and using databases and artificial intelligence to come up with answers. And within 24 hours, she became a racist. And I had to put her online because it was really terrible what she was tweeting. So those chatbots can be manipulated by the people that have conversations with it. So it's still an experimental phase, but IBM, using their artificial intelligence called IBM Watson, already won a famous game in America, Jeopardy, and they're working on it to implement artificial intelligence in kids' toys. They have a green dragon that uses already artificial intelligence, where your kid can talk to the toys and the toy will give them intelligent and hopefully non-racist answers. But one thing that really scares me is they will try to put artificial intelligence into Barbie. And I think that's the world upside down. Barbie, the dumb doll, becoming intelligent. This is science fiction, really. News of, I think it was 2 days ago, is that Elon Musk, the guy of the Tesla, the guy of SpaceX, the guy of the Hyperloop, invested in a new company that wants to implement technology so our brains can use artificial intelligence. So it doesn't matter if you have a low IQ or a high IQ, just put a chip in it. And when Elon Musk tries to do it, it will be available. It will be done, because he's a crazy guy, but he has all the money, all the context. Yeah, he's just an arrogant motherfucker and he wants to do it, so it will happen. And, well, thinking about customer experience, I think that every digitization you have to consider how it will affect the customer experience. It's not about your process, it's about the customer process. And there are a lot of examples. For this one is the Google Expeditions, and it's used in America for kids to go onto a school trip without leaving the school. So kids will put on the VR card box and they will see all places where it is impossible for them to go. And this is a replacement of human experience, what can be used to a certain level, but not to replace everything. I don't think you would like to have a hologram standing over here. You want to see real people. And I don't want to talk to screens, I want to talk to real people. So there is a limit to what we can do. But in the early days when we started to fly, this is how we did, everybody wants to experience how it's like to fly like a bird. And I can tell you, we will never learn how to fly ourselves. But we can feel what it's like using the birdie. It's a virtual reality machine where you can wave your wings, fly using your own wings, and there's a fan blowing air in your face like you are really flying. And this experience is amazing. If you get a chance to do it, you will feel what it's like to fly. This is nice. Glasses is becoming more real with this new suit that they're working on. It will give you heat, it will give you pressure. So when I walk in the rain, it will feel like I'm walking in the rain. I will feel the drops coming on my clothes. Imagine what this can do with porno. So I think digitization should enhance the customer experience, not replace it. Or it should be a new experience, like flying like a bird. But it should never replace the real experience. And When you look at the virtual reality and when you go to the augmented reality, like Pokemon is an example of that, we can use the Google glasses, well, if you can find one. But they're working on building lenses where you can project data and screens on. So you can put them in your eyes and you will see a digital layer on top of the real layer. And when this goes bad, it will look like this. This is scary. You can look up that video, it's called Hyper Reality. Look it up on YouTube. It will go on, including into the supermarket, all the advertising you will get while you're in the supermarket. And this might be really scary. But I think we're headed up to a world where this will be normal. And my advice is, let's digitize only the non-boring, non-significant, and the inefficient parts of your business. But never have a negative effect on the customer experience, because that's the reason why customers come back. And use digitizations to improve that experience. Now, I have an example of Malaga. Ever been to Spain in Malaga? Yeah. Did you see that on the beach there are small white restaurants? When you look on the Malaga beach, they have small houses with boats on the sand, including charcoal, where they roast fish. My wife and I were there 2 years ago, and we saw those houses, and we saw pictures of what you can eat there, but they were all closed. And there was a sign on the window that said, "We are only open when there is sun." There was no sun, so they were closed. So we tried it the next day, no sun, and the next day after that, finally there was sun, so we were the first to sit on the terrace. As you can see, there's nobody else there. And we wanted to see what it was like. And there were friendly waiters coming to us, what would you like to drink? And they gave us our drinks, they gave us an ashtray, cinecero in Spanish. And it was just great. And we wanted to eat something, but there was no menu. So we asked the waiter, "Can we eat something?" "Yeah." And he brings up a plate with five different fishes, fresh fish, fish of the day. And only one of them we recognized. It was the, how to say it, dorada. And okay, we'll have two of them. And he went away with our fish. And more people came to the terrace. And we saw him with our fishes full of salt walking over the terrace to the boat on the right side, where was a guy with the fire. And he put our fishes on sticks, roasting them, and we could smell it, and it smelled good, and a lot of people were ordering the same fishes. And yeah, I think 10 minutes later our fish was ready, and we saw the waiter coming with our fishes over the terrace, and we looked at them, but he went inside, and we were hungry, really hungry. But he came back with them, including fresh potatoes, fresh vegetables, already on the plate. And yeah, then we could start to eat. And you put your knife on it and the fish literally drops off the bones. And it tasted amazingly, like something we never had before. In the sun, already two white wines, and eating the most delicious dinner. But we hadn't seen the menu, we had no clue what the prices would be. So when we were ready, we asked them, "Hey, can we pay? Il conto?" And what do you think we had to pay? Any ideas?
40. 40.
I'm sorry? 50? No, we are Dutch, so we thought it would be 80 euros. And that would be fine, because it was a great place, great atmosphere, great personnel, great food, but we only had to pay 38 euros. for 3 wines each and those fishes. So that made us euphoric. We were really happy. We put it on, we still use that. We put it on Instagram, on Swarm, on Facebook, everywhere we let a review of that restaurant. You should have to go there whenever you're in Malaga. And that's one of the things that made me make up Euphoria Marketing. And this is something I wrote a lot of articles about. This is how the fish is prepared, by the way. Every company should think about the following elements to make their client euphoric. And the first one is your product or service. It needs to be top quality. Like the fish, there was nothing wrong with it. Actually, really nothing wrong. So make sure that the product or service that you sell is just top of the bill. The people that your company uses for interaction with the client need to be friendly. They need to be open-minded. When I call a company, I get a cranky old lady on the phone. I want to hang up. I want to talk to friendly people. When I visit a company, I want to see friendly people. The information you provide, in their case, it was just a plate with fishes on it and some pictures on how it should look like. But I have one more minute, sorry. Click. The information you provide on your website, on your brochures, everywhere that you have it, should be convincing for the customer. It should be clear what it's about. The next thing, the environment. Of course, we do not all have a beach. But when I look at your website, it should not look like link cars that I showed you earlier. It should be clear for me where to go. When I visit your company, your office, I want to be seated and have a nice espresso. Make it a good, welcome environment. If all those four are great, the pricing is not the element that's most important for people. If people have a good experience with the four top ones, the pricing should be just like anybody else in the market, so you don't have to compete on pricing. And don't forget the extra mile or the extra smile. What do you do more for your client after he bought your product or your service? And get 5 times wow. And to conclude my speech, it's the human touch that makes the human experience special. So do not digitize everything and make it a human thing. Thank you.
Thank you, Jan. You gave us a great vision of future and really, grazie mille, ci ha dato veramente una visione del futuro a volte interessante, a volte un po' che ci può spaventare, ma siamo qui e la strada è questa, che nel bene e nel male lo vogliamo o meno. Fate un altro grande applauso a Jan. Vi ricordo, anche Jan sarà con noi domani pomeriggio nel panel di chiusura nel quale raccogliamo tutte le domande, cioè cercheremo di fare le domande, selezioneremo le domande da quelle che ci manderete via Twitter. E siamo arrivati a chiusura della plenaria con un ultimo intervento.